Hey there, welcome to the Next Level Life Show. I'm your host, Bill Hargenrader, creator of the Next Level Life and best-selling author of Mars Journey Call to Action. Here today with a fun guest, a cool guest, an awesome guest, Chris Hoftun? I should have asked you how you say your last name. How do you say that?
That's correct.
Yeah. Awesome. So, Chris, we're going to go into what you do. So I'll read your bio now and then we'll get started. So Christopher Hoftun is the chairman and co-founder of Mars Institute Norway. After he conducted a study of planetary drilling at the Mars Institute at NASA Ames Research Center, California. He's also the program manager space systems at Zaptec headquarters in Stavanger, Norway, and based at Ames. He's currently investigating a new plasma drilling system under development, PLASMARS, love the name, by Zaptec and the European Space Agency. The plasma drill, it will enable deep subsurface access on asteroids, Mars and its moons for on-site science, investigation, sampling, and exploration. So we're going to talk a lot more about that. So as we get started, why don't you tell a little bit about yourself and maybe some of your journey, you know, how you got started, interested in drilling and, you know, came around the Mars Institute and Zaptec.
Well, hi, Bill. It's a pleasure to be here. So my journey actually started, I was a university student Stavanger at the university. And so my background is from petroleum engineering. So this is the capital of drilling in Norway, where I'm based right now. And I got involved in a very exciting network, which we're using technology transfer between space and energy sector. So we are quite experienced in drilling in the North Sea. And we connected this with NASA and robotics. So I had an internship.
Yeah.
The Mars Institute with Pascal Lee, and I had the pleasure to work with him and Chris McKay, Brian Glass, and Chris Sackney. So I pretty got good involved with some great figures in the frontiers of Mars exploration from the beginning. And after a year conducting this study, we found some developments or something that we found very interesting for the next steps to drill on Mars. In this case, we're looking deep drilling, way beneath the surface. And that case was plasma drilling, which we are studying right now. So it's actually a small coincidence that I'm working for Zaptec today, which is actually conducting the same study that we actually looked for in 2012. And since then, a lot of exciting things has happened. It's a great pleasure to be in the community, and I think it's great that the people like you, Bill, do this great effort to show people of what's happening. And I think this is a journey we're all aboard together on.
Yeah, no, that's awesome. That's a great way of looking at it. And we talked a little bit about before we started the interview about Zaptec and Mars Institute, and you know, you're talking about vision and accomplishing that vision. Can you talk a little bit more, you know, about what that is to you, what that means, how the two, you know, because for me, the community, the Mars community, the Mars, you know, human habitation exploration community, there's so many different, you know, pieces to the, you know, to the puzzle. There's people that want to be Martians, that want to go. There are people that want to concentrate on the science. There are people that want the human race, you know, to get there, but just want to sit behind a computer and maybe do interviews, you know. What is your take on, you know, combining that, seeing that vision, and then also actually taking the steps to make that happen?
So my approach so far, it's been, of course, be part of planning human missions to Mars. We've been going up to Devon Island in the high Arctic at the NASA Help Mars project, of course. So that's one angle of it. But so far, most of my effort has been in robotics drilling, looking for life beneath the surface, and how to achieve reaching down to up to 10 meters. We looked into kilometers as well, but that was more way in the future. So the big visionary is, of course, to find life on Mars. I like your cat in the background.
She'll do that. Yep, she roams.
So yeah, it's very exciting. I have a huge interest of finally seeing humans on Mars and actually be part of it to help that happen one day in the future. Yeah. And I think the planning needs to start today, not 10 years or 20 years or 30 years from today. So we're already working on the planet.
Yeah, absolutely. That's awesome. So I have a bit of a construction background, maybe growing up at, you know, from at this point over 20 years ago. So I'm familiar with plasma, you know, torch cutting and, you know, plasma welding. But, you know, what exactly is plasma drilling when it comes to, you know, the surface of the Earth or surface of Mars? How does that work?
So take it back to Earth for a bit. It's an old technology. The problem is you need a huge transformer to actually make it work. And that part is the unique part what we have developed. So you normally need a 300 pounds transformer, high voltage transformer. And so the cutting edge on this is this company have managed to develop a very small device which can actually manage to do the same. And I actually had it right here in my hand. So this one, this small little device, is actually can deliver the same effect as a transformer, more than 100 times its weight and volume and mass.
Wow.
That opens a lot of frontiers. So this technology is what we use for generating the pulses, the sparks. And there's a lot of different plasma drilling technologies, but our is based on something called plasma channel drilling, which generates a, of course, we can manage the frequencies of the pulses and the voltages. In this case, we are planning to use about 100 watts of power. And what happens is, I'm going to try to explain it. I actually have some gadgets here with me.
Please do.
So we are actually already testing this in the lab. We have a Mars lab here next to our facility.
Yeah.
We have a vacuum chamber. We can reach down to the Mars temperatures, Mars pressures, and drill in all kind of rocks, basalt, sandstones, testing everything you can imagine.
Yeah.
In practice, what happens is, so this is actually the tool we are, this is just a testing tool. It's not going to look like this at all. So it's about 5 centimeters in diameter. So the golden part is the grounding, and the center, you can see here close.
Yeah.
That's where the electrode is supposed to be. In this case, it's not there. So everything between the electrode and the grounding is going to be polarized by the pulses. So what happens in practice is it creates a micro channel, and like it vaporizes and creates some gases in the rock, and it works as a piston. So the it develops like a pressure inside the rock, and it expands. So it's like a piston, like breaks up the rock from inside. So instead of like inducing stresses on top of the rock, you just basically break it up from inside of it.
I like it. Then how's the material cleared?
That's a totally different approach. So so we are considering gas blasts of carbon dioxide. Which of course it's quite challenging to drill on Mars at these temperatures and pressures. So there's quite exciting phenomena as well. Like for example, if you heat up water ice, it sublimates and expands. You can basically just blow out, but that's another part. So we have been considering gas blasts, of course. We also have a mechanical part. So in this case, it's a mole. We're sending down a mole, and it's going to go up and down, like very old kind of system that they used several hundred years ago. But the problem is that the collapse of the borehole is a lot of factors, which is limiting, of course, the power, the weight. That's just some of them.
Yeah.
This is actually, I never shown this to anyone before. I'm not sure if it's, you're able to see it.
I can see it pretty clearly.
This is a sandstone. It's quite thin.
Yeah.
So this is actually one of the first rocks we've been testing on. And so we actually shot one pulse, and it went straight through the rock. You can see it entered here, and it came out here.
Nice.
So that's one of the first plasma drills for Mars. tests we ever conducted. And we're pretty early on in the development phase and testing. But I think a lot of exciting things are going to come out in the near future.
Yeah, I mean, that's pretty exciting to me right there. That's pretty cool. So, I mean, at this stage, we'll kind of circle over to a little bit more about the Mars Institute, portion. And we'll talk about the vision and Devon Island. And maybe can you tell a story? Have you been to Devon Island? Have you been up there? Have you been out in the Humvee with the tracks in the snow? Or
yes, I had a great pleasure. I went up there in 2012 in summer campaign. It took us about a week to fly from California up to Inuit land, like smaller and smaller communities, until we reached Devon Island. We were a small group of researchers and scientists that season, and it was amazing. You read about Devon Island, you see videos from it, but it's nothing like actually being there yourself. When you're in when you're at Devon Island and you look at the surroundings, it really feels like Mars. It's quite extraordinary feeling to be there. And and we did some testing of some drills with NASA, with Brian Glass, the icebreaker drill. And we also did some, conducted other research as well. And it's definitely a place to go.
Yeah, right. No, that's cool. I've seen some of the Mars Institute, some of the posts, and I haven't watched this yet. I checked this out, but Passage to Mars. Were you guys involved in that?
Mars. Yes. Is that Jules Verne's documentary?
Yeah.
My understanding is it's just finished the documentary, and it's coming out pretty soon. I watched it myself, and it's really good. It's something that you definitely should see as well if you're interested in more science.
Yeah, so we'll just a brief rundown. Like I just seen the trailer, but what's the premise?
So they're driving a Humvee up to Devon Island through the Northwest Passage, They have some challenges because the ice is breaking up at some point. It's also the environment is quite harsh. It's quite cold, a lot of wind. And you don't have extra parts. And some of the technical parts of the car starts breaking up. And you can imagine being out in the middle of nowhere. You can't see left from right. And your car is breaking down, and the ice beneath you is actually starting to break up as well. And they have a lot of challenges, and they're using this to simulate, of course, how to use a pressurized rover on Mars, some of the challenges. So there's a lot of links to actually roving Mars in the future. And even in our backyard, it's that hard. You can imagine how it's supposed to be on Mars.
Oh yeah, no, and that's why I like the idea of it, and looking forward to watching that, because a lot of times with Mars, it's about getting out there, but the science of it, talk about the challenge, talk about the vision of it, but then it's also the reality is that it's super super hard, and there's places on Earth that it's hard to get around and to move around. So when we go after these challenges of putting human footprints on Mars surface, there are these things that are going to come up. So a movie like that, Passage to Mars, shows on our own planet how we overcome the difficulties and how hard it is. And just I'm really looking forward to that, to watching that.
Pretty cool. And Pascal is a pioneer in exploration of Mars as well. He's if he wasn't born and raised in France and China, he would definitely be a Norwegian, because he's a polar exploration, like polar explorer, and he has Norwegian blood in his veins.
Have you told him that before?
No, but I've been part of some of his explorations here in my backyard in Stavanger as well, and that was very fun. Actually, the first time I met Pascal, he came here to Norway, and we had a great talk for a lot of people there at the university, and I was co-hosting the event, and I was taking him to this old Viking communities here next door. And somehow I missed the track. So suddenly we were walking downhill and I was like middle of nowhere, like bushes and everything. And I was like, oh my God, where am I taking this scientist? Like, this is middle of nowhere. But he loved it. Like, that was exactly what he likes to do. Like, he's a real explorer by heart.
Yeah, and he's a great guy. I reached out to him also through a mutual friend that I met at a space startup weekend event, which basically a startup weekend event. It's a 4-day event where people go and they create, you know, it's a contest to create a startup, and then they basically, you know, pitch them to a, you know, panel of judges. And through that event, I did a Mars focused type of business project. Through that, I got introduced to Pascal, spoke to him on the phone a couple times. And I'm an author of science fiction thriller, you know, writer. And I asked him some questions, you know, and he gave me some thoughts and things of that nature. And this is actually his book, Mission to Mars. And this is for kids, but it is so good. It's so like detailed and like up to date. I literally, as I'm writing like adult level science fiction, I'm like, wait, what did Pascal say here, you know, in the kids version of Mission to Mars? So
I think that book is for adults as well. It's even more like, even adults like it as much as kids.
Yeah, definitely. All right. So going back to our flow here, we're keeping an eye on time. We're still good. So I would just say that I love your energy, love your enthusiasm. You know, talking about the explorer, you know, blood, the Norwegian explorer blood. And we talk about this thing called the entrepreneur's journey. And it's almost like an exploration of sorts, because things don't always go well for you. Sometimes you don't always meet the right person. So what would you say to somebody that's watching this that might have an idea that can help get us to Mars, or might have an idea just for running any type of business, but they see that this challenge is so big? What would you say to that person, or advice that you would give to somebody like that?
First of all, I think passion is the key. Like, you really need to be passionate about what you do. Despite of if it's space or other areas, like, you really need to have the passion, and it's never going to be easy. You're going to hit the wall, and you need to keep going. And you have developments, you have setbacks, and it's going to be like that all the time. And but when you finally make the breakthrough, that's when it feels so amazing. And you look back and you see all what we actually have accomplished, because day by day, it's very hard to see what actually have happened. But for example, if you look back the last year or the last 6 months and you see what you have actually managed to do, that's where you actually see some of the results. By following your heart, dedicating yourself day by day, it's tough plowing up new land like the pioneers. Like, you go places or do something that's never done before, and it's of course going to be tough. And by joining up forces with people similar to you and or even with different backgrounds, I think that's a big key to success. Like, finding those people with the same affection that you have and aligning up. You definitely need someone like that.
Yeah, no, that's great advice. Because, yeah, definitely do something you're passionate about. If you don't know what you're passionate about, get out there and try different things. But definitely lock that in, because there'll be some late nights, some late weekends, some points where you're, what is a weekend? Because you're just working. Some people say TGIF, thank God it's Friday, which is a saying here in the United States for me and my wife who run our business. It's like, it's Friday, you know, we're working. Saturday, we're working. But because we're passionate about what we're doing, we're doing this on a Saturday, you know, it's late there on a Saturday, we're passionate about it. So it's, you know, it's fun for us, and we kind of blur the lines between, you know, working what you do. So I think that's amazing advice, actually. So then one of the questions we have here is, there's lots of, it's kind of like a, not a trick question, but it's a complicated question. You know, there's a lot of people that have different ideas about getting to Mars, going to the moon first, going to Mars moons first, going to the Martian orbit first. Like, do you have any thoughts on that? Or you just want to go just period? Do you have any ideas or thoughts on that?
So I think we need to take one step at a time. It's the same thing as developing technologies. Like, you need to start somewhere, and you need to test it, and you need to go back and you remodel and develop new, and then go further. So I think that, of course, we've been to the moon. It's hard to argue like, why should we go back again when we have already been there? like NASA's been there a while back, and the Europeans and the Chinese are already talking to go in there. I think the asteroids, in particular, the moons of Mars, is highly prospects we should investigate further. And by sending a human missions to the asteroid, like to Phobos and Deimos, you get much closer to Mars. Of course, the space travel in that time range is of course going to be quite challenging. And so far, like, we don't have the current technology to send humans down to Mars, at least not send them back again. And I think that's the place to start. It's not that sexy as actually going to Mars itself, but I think it's definitely going to be a important stepping stone to finally get to Mars.
I like that. I like that. I like how we work sexy into the Mars conversation as well. Mars is sexy. Well, awesome. So we're kind of wrapping up on our time here. I always like to, you know, ask our guests, is there anything that you'd like to draw special attention to, something you have coming up, or a website or something that we can direct our audience to?
So we in the Mars Institute, we love to contribute our work, what we're doing in the science community, to people that not necessarily need to be scientists themselves. We're opening up for opportunities. We have student internships. We have a lot of talks. Pascal has this great book as well. So some of the work besides our science is actually involving in the community itself to reach out and tell them what was actually happening and get some inputs as well. If you're in the area at NASA Ames or somehow in Norway, please get in touch. We're happy to show you some of the exciting stuff we're doing, and maybe we can sit down and have a discussion about sending humans to Mars or finding life on Mars.
I love it. We're going to put your links down, social media, Mars Institute, .no for Norway, right?
Yes. So a lot of exciting things are going to happen about the Mars Institute as well. We are in a pretty early stage, but we are going to develop a small, it's more for fun, like a part from the shelf, like a Mars rover, like a small hybrid between ExoMars and Curiosity. It's more for educational usage. And of course, we in Zaptec, we intend to put our plasma drill. The complete system is about less than 20 kilos or about 40 pounds. And we want to take it to Devon Island and test it. And so of course, let me.
Yeah, please do.
So this is actually the ExoMars, and the part in front of it is actually our drill. So basically, that's how we intend it to look like. Of course, there's a lot of things to happen before something like that happened, but at least we want to put our drill on the rover and actually go roving Devon Island maybe next summer. And we should definitely make something publicly available on that part as well.
Yeah, and when you do that, I'll definitely put that out to the I Love Mars community. That's cool. That's the kind of stuff I like to see, things that are actually happening real in the real world that are taking place. That's very cool. It's just interesting. I was thinking here, we've actually been trying to sync up for, you know, a little bit now, maybe a month and a half or so, maybe even more. Anyway, it's funny because I was writing a second novella in this My Mars Journey Call to Action series. And just independently, this is back like 3 months ago, I wrote that one of the co-founders of an organization called Mars Now, in the book, it plays a central role, was from Norway, had like a petroleum and like economics like background, like all these things. And then like I got introduced to you and I'm like, he's going to think that I wrote this based on him. But
the world is small, coincidences.
Yeah, yeah. So, well, Chris, this is really great. Thank you for your time. I'm gonna just out to the different groups. Just thank you for joining me.
Pleasure was all mine, and keep up the good work, Bill.
Awesome. Thank you, Chris. For those of you out there, if you enjoyed this video, please give it a like or a thumbs up. Subscribe for more videos, and I will see you on the next one. Take care. Bye.